in your word, dear Lord. Lead me, guide me every day. Send your anointing, Father, I pray. Order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word.
I have heard thy voice, and it told my love to thee, and I long to ride in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and thy will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, to thy precious bleeding side.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. O God, O Father, great generous Father, we thank you this evening for allowing us to hear your word one more time. We ask, Lord, that everyone take and understand more fully and learn to be better Christians after this sermon. Father God, I ask that you put me behind you, and that the words of my mouth be yours and not mine. Amen. Generous grace. The text reads, "For the grace of God has appeared, offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. A man stood before the judge awaiting sentence. The judge looked at the admitted felon in the eye and said, 'The penalty is hereby waived. You are free to go.' But judge, the man asserted, 'I confess my guilt. How am I able to leave here a free man? Grace was the judge's only reply. In the summer of 1755, George Washington was a colonel under the command of General British Braddock during the French and Indian War. When Braddock's forces marched against Fort Dunsky in July of 1755, they were surprised by the French and Indian forces and routed. General Braddock was killed, and Washington led the remaining soldiers in a retreat to Virginia. Colonel Washington had two horses killed beneath him and counted four bullet holes in his coat when he finally arrived back in Virginia. Washington, in spite of the bullet holes found in his coat, was not hurt. He believed he had been spared by God's grace and wrote the following to his brother, John Augustine. I now exist and appear in the land of the living by the miraculous care of Providence that protected me beyond all human expectation. Grace, unmerited favor. It's what you and I receive every day as Christ's followers. We sin, but our judge spares us a verdict of guilty. We are favored because we have confessed sins before an all-forgiving Savior. Before we explore this phenomenon called grace, allow me to explain our scripture text for a clearer understanding. The Apostle Paul is not saying that grace falls like a blanket over mankind. A clearer translation would be this: the grace of God that brings salvation to all men has appeared teaching. Do you hear the not so subtle difference? Grace is offered to everyone, but only through salvation. Grace is given to those who accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. It is showered on those who are saved. If the unsaved are recipients of God's grace, it is only because God often applies his grace with a sweeping hand. I've heard many believers say about stories or tell stories of narrow escapes by God's grace. But Satan, the prince of the world, spares his imps. Paul is boasting that the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men who accept it. So today, we want to focus on what God's grace is and why he grants it. Let's look at this miracle called grace. First, grace appeared in Bethlehem in the form of God's only begotten Son. I know it's not Christmas time, but the message of grace is not confined to Christmas. The grace that was ushered in at Christmas means we no longer have to grope for God and search painfully for a spiritual connection. God is here. He is ever present. We waited for him and he has come. God's self-originated love has no motive but itself. Grace delights to act, not according to merit, but on the impulses of its own heart. You can't earn grace or solicit grace or summon grace. Grace just is, because the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Second, it's a gift. But what kind of gift? It's a gift that brings salvation to all men. It's not salvation, but it is God's motivation for offering the gift of salvation. God could not help himself. He saw the havoc that sin was causing man. He was tired of being separated from his creation. So his abounding and overflowing love found a way, through his grace, to reunite man with his creator. If God could save all men through grace, he would do it. The love that lives in eternity has flowed through generations of human history and is an ever-waiting shower itself on all men. But grace is conditional by the very nature of the gift it carries. And while this gift is offered to all mankind, sadly, many leave it on the shelf, unwrapped. And if God's medicine stands on the shelf, the sick man cannot be cured. He has to reach for his medicine and take it. It's not the medicine's failure if the man dies eternal death. That blame can only fall on the one who refused to take the medicine. Who but an irrational being would leave such a gift? Imagine how the Apostle Paul felt. He called himself a chief sinner. He probably thought, if it can save me, it can save anybody. Think of how God has cleaned you up. You know what you used to be like, and you know how God changed you. And you know that he can change you even more if you would only let him. Grace, therefore, is an outward expression of mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. As believers, we quickly learn to recognize grace as a part of our daily lives. Grace wakes us up in the morning. Grace clears our mind. Grace cures our unbelief. Grace removes our doubt. Grace humbles our spirits. Grace renews our faith. Grace grants us peace. Finally, let's look at the discipline of grace. Here comes the teaching part. Paul says that grace comes through salvation, and it comes teaching us. If teaching was just instruction, we would welcome it with open arms. But God's teaching also includes necessary chastisement. We learn the same way our children learn. God does what no other teacher can do. He imparts his instruction into our spirits and imparts his knowledge as well as some great or gentle illumination. Yes, illumination. Sometimes we wish that part was less frequent. We suffer from bad decisions. It's illuminating. We struggle through challenging circumstances. It's illuminating. When we face adversarial conditions, it's illuminating. But God takes over to teach us to hang in there, realize our mistakes, and to lean on Jesus. Sometimes the rod is best. On the Isle of Patmos, God told John to write, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous and repent." What we need is a little more zeal for righteousness, and we will suffer less correction. No one likes discipline, but it is a necessary part of our spiritual growth. If we would enroll ourselves in God's school of grace, accept his correction, and submit to his chastisement as a demonstration of his love, we will learn to bear better fruit. Sin won't be able to blemish our beauty. Sin won't be able to remove our hope. Sin won't be able to ruin our joy. Sin won't be able to devastate our peace. Sin won't be able to ruin our reputation. Sin won't be able to harden our hearts. Sin won't be able to shame our face. Grace will take us from the gutter to glorious, miserable to marvelous, filthy to fabulous, pathetic to precious, horrible to heavenly, dingy to desirable, immoral to immaculate, corrupt to commendable, shameful to sanctified, devilish to divine, rotten to reliable, gloomy to glowy, disgraceful to deceased, to decent. Grace, who can pass up such a gift? Will you come to Christ and allow grace to turn your sorrow into joy, your feuds into friendships, your pride into humility, your conceit into compassion, your hatred into forgiveness, forgiveness, not hate, but forgiveness, your revenge into love, your turmoil into peace, your problems into solutions. Your darkness into light. God, through his omniscient grace, offers Christ to you, my brother and sister. Will you accept his gift? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. 'Twas grace that brought me safe thus far. 'Twas grace that brought me liberty. And grace will lead me home. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amen.
May not be the best of anything, nor have the best of anything. Sometimes I feel like I'm the least of all. But I know someone who has everything. That someone is my everything, and I'm happy just to know I'm his child. His name is Jesus, righteous Son of God, Lily of the Valley. He's the bright and morning star. His name is Jesus. He is my everything. Oh, yes, he is. I'm so happy just to know I'm his child. I may not be the best of anything, nor have the best of anything. Sometimes I feel like I'm the least of all, but I know someone who has everything. That someone is my everything, and I'm happy just to know I'm his child. Righteous Son of God, Lily of the Valley, he's the bright and morning star. His name is Jesus. He is my everything. Oh, yes, he is. I am happy just to know. I am happy just to know. I am happy just to know. I'm his child.
We close now. Father, thank you for the words from my mouth. I hope that everyone learned something from your words this evening. Thank you. Closing. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, and dominion and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.
To my heart, Holy Spirit, give me the word that will bring new life. Words on the wind.
From the wings of the morning, the dark clouds.
If you speak to my heart. If I can't hear from you, then I know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide. Hey, speak to my heart. Hey, give me your holy word. If I can hear from you.
Escape being afraid. bring with it a sound that points us to you right now. Erase substitutes right now. Fix what I see. And God, please fix me. My world needs you right now. Let us see you.
That's why I'm not ashamed to say.